फ्रेंड्स वी आर गोइंग टू द नेक्स्ट टॉपिक फ्रॉम जनसर्जरी द टॉपिक इज ऑन शॉक वन ऑफ द इंटरेस्टिंग टॉपिक्स एंड इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक्स फॉर योर एग्जाम्स अगेन इज शॉक सो वी विल डिस्कस द शॉक इन डिटेल नाउ सो प्लीज अंडरस्टैंड शॉक लाइक ए प्रैक्टिकल प्रैक्टिशनर सो डोंट रीड इन मग इट अप एंड वेस्ट योर टाइम ऑन दिस I request you to read this shock like a practitioner so that you will never forget the points which I am going to tell you now. So why should I discuss shock in a surgical session? Can you tell me? So shock is the most common cause of death in a surgical patient. Please don't forget, shock is the most common cause of death in surgical patients. The most common cause of death in surgical patients is shock. So in shock, there are many types of shocks which we are surgeons less interested in. As a surgeon, we want you to know two important types of shocks. What are the two important type of shocks? If you ask me, I will tell you. In broad outline, one is hypovolemic shock. Another is septic shock, which is coming under the classification distributive shock. So distributive shock and hypovolemic shock are the two important shocks I want you to know in this topic. So in hypovolemic shock, I am going to discuss only one shock, that is hemorrhagic shock. In distributive shock, I am going to discuss only one shock, that is septic shock. So hemorrhagic shock and septic shock. So these are the two important shocks I am going to discuss. To understand these two types of shocks, you need not mug up anything. Just remember the diagram I am going to make now. So if you understand this diagram, you need not mug up at all. You will easily remember what is the features of shock. I am drawing a person here. This is heart. I am going to tell you five parameters now. So now, the heart is pumping blood, okay, the pumping blood that is coming under the heading known as cardiac output. So first thing you should know is cardiac output. The heart is pumping 5.5 liters of blood, cardiac output, and that is going through arteries to where? To the peripheries. Through the arteries it is going to the peripheries, and that is producing a resistance known as peripheral arterial resistance or peripheral vascular resistance. So please understand, that is producing a resistance in my limbs known as peripheral vascular resistance. That you must know next. Then the oxygen will be consumed by the tissues. That is known as oxygen consumption. The peripheral tissues will consume the oxygen. Oxygen consumption. And please don't forget, the blood will come back to the heart through veins. That is known as venous resistance. Venous resistance. And finally, you should know, when you take sample of blood from the heart and see how much amount of oxygen being consumed, that is known as mixed venous oxygen saturation. I am giving 100% oxygen to a patient. I am taking sample of blood and I will now measure the mixed venous oxygen saturation. So please don't forget cardiac output, peripheral vascular resistance, oxygen consumption, venous resistance, and mixed venous oxygen saturation. We are going to discuss for these two shocks now. So I'm again telling you, don't waste time on mugging up. Just understand what is happening. In an hemorrhagic shock, a patient is losing blood. Around 2 liters of blood is lost. Naturally, his cardiac output will be low or high. His cardiac output will be decreased. Septic shock, the blood is not lost. It is there in his body only. So, there will be cardiac output will be increased. Please remember, it is increased. Peripheral vascular resistance, as a natural protective phenomenon of heart, the arteries will vasoconstrict in case of hemorrhagic shock. So peripheral vascular resistance increases in hemorrhagic shock and decreases in septic shock. The peripheral vessels are dilated. The septic shock, the major issue is the blood is pulled into the dilated blood vessels like femoral artery, tibial artery, radial artery, all arteries are vasodilated due to the toxins released from the bacteria. The toxins are causing vasodilatation, so the blood pressure falls due to the ineffective blood which is pooled in the peripheries. So the patients therefore have warm peripheries in case of septic shock, but in case of hemorrhagic shock, patients will have cold peripheries. And oxygen consumption, you can see in a hemorrhagic shock, the peripheral tissues are craving for oxygen. So the moment you give oxygen, they will be having increased consumption of oxygen will be there by the peripheral tissues. But in a septic shock, the peripheral tissues will have decreased oxygen consumption. In spite of good flow, they will not engulf the oxygen. So therefore, the oxygen will go back to the heart. So venous resistance is decreased as a natural phenomenon in both cases, so that the heart will have good blood flow. So in this, both are same. Please remember, venous resistance is decreased in both hemorrhagic shock as well as septic shock. And last year, NEET 2018 question, mixed venous oxygen saturation in hemorrhagic shock is less than 50%. So normal value of MVOS is 50 to 70% comes back to the heart. But in case of hemorrhagic shock, more than 50% is consumed by the peripheries. So the returning oxygen is less than 50%. In a septic shock, it is returning as such back. So it is more than 70%. So please remember, hemorrhagic shock and septic shock, the points you must note are, in hemorrhagic shock, it is less than 50%. In septic shock, it is more than 70%. This is a repeat question. So you can now have a clear-cut idea of what is hemorrhagic shock and what is septic shock. We surgeons will deal only with these two shocks. We don't discuss an anaphylactic shock, is very rare to see in a surgical ward, or a cardiogenic shock, or a patient who is getting a neurogenic shock. All those are all there. But for a surgical topic, you should know hemorrhagic shock and septic shock. What are the parameters? These are the parameters in hemorrhagic and septic shock. So please don't forget these parameters in hemorrhagic and septic shock. So now, shock patients in your ward, you are resuscitating them by various means. Now, how to find out the response to your resuscitation? So monitoring of shock. Again, another important, this topic which I am discussing now, shock, is high yield for AIMS. So monitoring of shock. So please remember, monitoring of shock I am going to discuss now. Monitoring of shock, please don't forget these points. Clinical monitor is one type of monitor we have. Clinical monitor is one type of monitor just by measuring some clinical methods. And lab values is another method of monitoring. And by measuring some CVP or PCWPP. So this is another method. Central venous pressure or pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is another method. So clinical method of monitoring, is the best of all. It is the best parameter to monitor, adequacy of resuscitation. Please remember, best parameter to measure adequacy of resuscitation is by means of what? Very well known answer, urine output. Please don't forget. Best clinical parameter, best method to monitor adequacy of resuscitation, both is urine output. No confusion in this, no controversy in this. This is a direct line. Best clinical parameter for monitoring of shock, best method to monitor the adequacy of resuscitation is urinary output. And best clinical parameter to look for, tissue perfusion. For tissue perfusion is also urine output. For tissue perfusion, clinical parameter is urine output. And for your confusion, there is another question. Best monitor to look for tissue perfusion. The question is not asking clinical monitor, best monitor to look for tissue perfusion. They are asking best monitor or a lab value for a tissue perfusion. What is the answer? So that is, that will give a pakka guidance whether the tissue perfusion is going on well or not. That is by measuring serum lactate level. By measuring serum lactate level is high yield MCQ again. Serum lactate is the best lab value to monitor the adequacy of tissue perfusion. In serum lactate, if it is less than 2 millimoles per liter, you have done good resuscitation is done by you. The serum lactate level is good if it is less than 2. If it is more than 5 millimoles per liter, you have done a bad resuscitation for them. So less than 2 millimoles per liter is good resuscitation done. More than 5 millimoles per liter, bad resuscitation done by you. So please don't forget, this is another important value for tissue perfusion. So there is again another question, best method to monitor GIT and muscle perfusion is also again serum lactate level. The best method to monitor GIT and muscle perfusion is again serum lactate level. Then what is the question for CVP? What is the question for CVP? So the question for CVP is, CVP is used to measure, is used to monitor amount of fluids that should be given. Please remember, it is used to monitor amount of fluid to be given and also to monitor the drug dosage. Drug dosage, amount of fluid to be given, drug dosage, everything is done with the help of CVP. CVP is used to monitor amount of drug to be given and drug dosage is calculated with CVP. In CVP, there is a question. CVP is not accurate for which shock? For direct line from Bailey and Love, CVP is not accurate for cardiogenic shock and also for another shock known as septic shock. So CVP is not ideal for these two cases, cardiogenic shock and septic shock. So for cardiogenic shock, we use pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. So for a cardiogenic shock, the best method to decide the drug dosage and amount of fluids to be given is by means of pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. So please don't get confused. I used to get so many questions from students based on this resuscitation alone. While shock is getting resuscitated, what all things you monitor? You will put a Foley's catheter and you will measure the output. So urine output is the best method overall and best method to assess by clinical method and best to look for tissue perfusion clinically is urine output and by lab value is serum lactate. So best method to best lab value to measure, if they ask you, you have to go for serum lactate level. Please don't forget these points. So pulmonary capillary wedge pressure and central venous pressure, please don't forget. These are high yield MCQ points, you should never forget. Clinical, lab values and CVP, pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. These are the issues you should not forget here. Okay. So next, let us discuss one by one the various types of shocks. Let me first start my discussion on hemorrhagic shock. So we are discussing now hemorrhagic shock. Hemorrhagic shock is one of the important shocks we see in trauma. It has the following four types of hemorrhagic shocks are there. They are the following. Hemorrhagic shock type 1, type 2, type 3 and type 4. The main difference in this hemorrhagic shock is based on the amount of blood lost in trauma. In type 1 shock, the amount of blood lost is 15% of the body volume. 15% of the body volume is lost in type 1 shock. In type 2 shock, 15 to 30% is lost. 15 to 30% is lost. In type 3 shock, 30 to 40% of blood is lost. In type 4, more than 40% blood is lost. So this question was asked last year in a different way. In an adult, the amount of blood lost is 750 ml or less. 750 to 1500 ml. 1500 ml to 2000 ml, more than 2 liters. So this is another method of classifying the hemorrhagic shock. So hemorrhagic shock can be classified based on the amount of blood lost. Okay, this is one first point. And how to differentiate these shocks is by measuring certain values. We will measure pulse rate of the patient, respiratory rate of the patient, pulse pressure of the patient, blood pressure of the patient, mental status of the patient, urine output of the patient, are the classically used monitoring values. Now the first point is, in class 1 shock, it is just like donating a blood. You all would have gone to blood bank and you would have donated 1 unit of blood. Bailey says the amount of blood donated in a blood transfusion is 450 ml, but practically we do 350 ml in India. Bailey says 450 ml of blood is donated, and when you donate a blood, your pulse rate will not be altered, your respiratory rate will not be altered, your pulse pressure will be normal, BP will be normal, your mental status will be normal, and urine output will be normal. That nothing will be affected because your body will compensate, and therefore you need not give anything for such type of patients. If at all you can give, only oral fluids is enough. Such patients, you can give only oral fluids is enough. If at all maximum, we can give only IV crystallites. So you all would have seen in a blood bank, after the donating of blood, they will give 200 ml of fruity or something for drinking. That is main purpose. So this is just 750 ml of blood is lost, nothing happens, no value gets altered, everything is same. And this is a 100 times asked question. In which shock pulse rate increases? Pulse rate start increases from class 2 shock. Respiratory rate starts increasing from class 2 shock. Pulse pressure decreases from class 2 shock. These 3 points happens in class 2 shock. So pulse rate increases, respiratory rate increases, and pulse pressure decreases, and which is unaffected is blood pressure is unaffected in class 2 shock. Urine output starts decreasing. Patient is mild anxious, mild anxious patient. Anxious patient is anxious, he is mildly anxious. And class 3 shock, the BP also falls down, the blood pressure also falls down in class 3 shock. This is again another question. In which shock blood pressure falls down? It is in class 3 shock, blood pressure falls, and patient is more anxious and even confused. He is even confused or more anxious. Urine output decreases still more, and patient can go for anuria, and patient can be comatose in class 4 shock. Comatose and anuria in class 4 shock, and BP may be quarry, and pulse rate may be quarry, means feeble and unable to measure. So these all will happen in class 4 shock. So the ideal fluid for a class 2 and class 3 shock is IV crystallites are started immediately. For a class 2 and class 3 shock, IV crystallites are started immediately. And for class 4, the best fluid should be given is, best is blood immediately should be transfused. Blood transfusion is a must in case of class 4 shock. So please remember, these are the four grades of hemorrhagic shock: class 1, class 2, class 3, class 4. So class 1 is less than 750 ml, class 2 is 750 to 1500 ml, 1500 to 2000 is 3, more than 2 liters is 4, and BP falls in class 3, pulse rate, respiratory rate and pulse pressure are altered in class 2. So now let us see what we do in a hemorrhagic shock patient admitted in your hospital. So this is a casualty, this is a patient admitted with a severe bleeding, somewhere he is bleeding. So he has lost so much of blood and he is admitted in the casualty. Hemorrhagic shock patient in your casualty, or a road traffic accident following a trauma, the patient is admitted in your casualty, what are you going to do for this patient? So the moment you receive this patient, if the BP is less than 90 systolic, or if the pulse rate is more than 110 per minute in a hemorrhagic shock patient, if the BP is less than 90 and pulse rate is 110 per minute, there is a trial which is advising what? There is a trial, crash to trial. What they advise? Can you tell me? Crash to trial advises you to put injection tranexamic acid. They advise you to put injection tranexamic acid. Please don't forget this. So crash to trial advises you to put injection tranexamic acid for these patients. So tranexamic acid can be given stat, and at the point of trauma itself, we can advise the paramedical people to give tranexamic acid in trauma patient according to crash to trial. This is first point you should not forget.
and immediately start to Venflan according to ATLS manual 10th edition. What Venflan will you start for these patients? We should start two green Venflan. What size is it? It is 18 gauge, two green Venflan started on both side of the limb. Both side you have to start two green Venflan immediately on either side of the limb and infuse. What is the first infused fluid? IV fluid that is given immediately is what? 1 liter of crystalloid, that is 7.5% hypertonic saline is ideally given. So please don't forget, 1 liter of 7.5% hypertonic saline should be infused immediately. So 2 green Venflan started and 1 liter of 7.5 hypertonic saline is infused. Don't delay, immediately infuse this. And if you want to do blood transfusion, you want to do blood transfusion, so what unit of blood you can infuse without doing any cross matching immediately? It is O negative is preferred for reproductive age females. In trauma centers there will be O negative blood available in the trauma center itself. Without doing cross matching we can transfuse O negative blood. And if you want to transfuse for male, we can give O positive. Post reproductive females and males we can give O positive. For reproductive age female we must give O negative blood immediately. So 2 green Venflan 18 gauge started, 1 liter of 7.5 hypertonic saline is going on and O negative blood is given for uncross matched. And there is a new protocol now known as balanced resuscitation. What do you mean by balanced resuscitation in trauma? So balanced resuscitation in trauma, what does it signify means? So we don't infuse only blood now. The recent protocol advises we must infuse 1:1 of packed red blood cell is to plasma, fresh frozen plasma, and one more unit of platelet is infused now. So for a patient who is having severe bleeding, patient comes to hospital, we transfuse blood in the form of 1 unit packed red cell, 1 unit plasma, 1 unit platelet to prevent coagulopathy. This is used to prevent coagulopathy and it actually avoids the coagulopathy. So this is the latest protocol of balanced resuscitation. And another protocol is permissible hypotension. What is this new concept? Permissible hypotension. So for example, your patient injured here is having a cut injury of leg. For example, his leg is cut like this. He is bleeding from the leg only. He is bleeding from the leg. So now, what you should do is, we should raise the BP to such a way that clotted vessels, the vessels which are clotted now, should not reopen. At the same time, the brain should also receive good amount of blood supply. So the blood pressure should not become normal or should not be very low. It should be in such a way the blood also will receive enough blood supply to the brain. Brain also receives enough blood supply, as well as the cut limb also will not re-bleed. So that is known as permissible hypotension. To provide adequate brain supply as well as to prevent re-bleeding. So some way between the systolic pressure will be maintained between 90 like that to prevent re-bleeding and also to maintain adequacy of brain flow. So this is known as permissible hypotension. These are the points you should not forget in management of hemorrhagic shock. These are the things you should not forget in management of hemorrhagic shock. So at this point let me tell you the cannulas. So this is a repeat question asked in cannulas. So about the cannulas, let us discuss about the cannulas. So please don't forget, the cannulas or IV Venflans can be of following colors. The colors of cannulas are, what are the colors? Commonly used colors, gray. What are others? Gray, green, then gray, green, pink, blue, yellow. These are the commonly available 5 Venflan in your hospital. So what is the size of each? Gray venflan is 16 gauge, green venflan is 18 gauge, pink is 20 gauge, blue is 22 gauge, yellow is 24 gauge. Yellow is 24 gauge. So there is a repeat question in AIIMS exam to infuse maximum IV fluids. To infuse maximum IV fluids in a dehydration patient or a diarrhea patient, what is the best cannula? Answer is gray venflan, in which we can infuse 200 ml per minute. We can infuse just like that, 200 ml per minute can be infused. In a minute, you can infuse 200 ml per minute. So in a dehydration and diarrhea, the best venflan is 200 ml per minute infusing gray venflan. But in a trauma, what I told you just now, in a trauma, we will not use gray venflan. Previous protocols, 9th edition, 8th edition were telling gray venflan, but 10th edition clearly says we must use 2 green venflan, and through 1 green venflan we can infuse 80 ml per minute can be infused. Through 1 green venflan we can infuse 80 ml per minute can be infused in 1 green venflan. So please don't forget, 80 ml per minute can be infused through green venflan. So gray venflan 200 ml per minute can be infused. So cannulas is high yield MCQ. Please don't forget, in pediatric we use 22 gauge and in newborn we use 24 gauge. So they have less amount of fluid infusion, which is not essential for your exams. Please remember, green 80 ml per minute, gray 200 ml per minute is a repeat question. Okay, high flow is obtained through gray venflans only. And next point here you should not forget is, in hemorrhagic shock is, you should not forget there is one concept known as damage control resuscitation, damage control surgery. We are going to discuss it in detail now. Damage control surgery or damage control resuscitation. So damage control resuscitation, what does it signify? This is an operation which is going to prevent the dangerous triad of trauma known as what? Dangerous triad of trauma is hypothermia, dangerous triad of trauma, hypothermia, acidosis, coagulopathy. Hypothermia, acidosis, coagulopathy is the triad of, dangerous triad of trauma. This is prevented by damage control resuscitation, which is of 3 phases according to Sabiston. Phase 1, phase 2, phase 3. These are the 3 phases which is given in Sabiston. Bailey and Love gives us 5 stages, but actual ATLS protocol also advises 3 phases. So let me discuss the 3 phases of damage control surgery or damage control resuscitation. The phase 1 happens at which place? Phase 2 happens at which place? Phase 3 happens at which place is the first question. Phase 1 is a procedure happening in emergency OT, emergency operation theater with a less facilities. We are doing phase 1. Phase 2, it is happening in ICU, surgical intensive care ICU. Phase 3 is happening in elective OT in the presence of professors and specialists. So phase 1, emergency OT, what you must do? In a phase 1 in emergency OT, shift the patient to OT, open the abdomen, full laparotomy is done. For example, if there is an abdominal injury, full laparotomy is done. Open the abdomen and you must not try to do definitive surgeries. For example, if there is a liver laceration, I will not go and repair it, I will just go and pack it. I will just go and pack it. If there is a bowel injury, I will not go and repair the bowel now. I will just go and bring the bowel outside as ileostomy. So in emergency OT, I will do damage control surgery. My aim is not to do definitive repair. My aim is to stop further bleeding. To stop further bleeding and to stop further contamination. That is my aim. My aim in a trauma center, in a patient, especially in coagulopathy, is to stop bleeding and to stop further contamination. That's all. To stop bleeding and to stop further contamination is my aim. So I will immediately do these things, and I will not even close the abdomen. I will come out of the theater by just keeping a sheet on the abdomen which is already open, because I am however going to open it after some time. So I will just keep a sheet like this on the abdomen. What is the name of this sheet covering? There are many names. Indian method commonly done in government hospitals is Bagota bag. Bagota bag technique is commonly used in our setup. Bagota bag, plastic bag. And upside dressing is also available. Upside dressing. Western countries, they use vacuum assisted closure devices. They use vacuum assisted closure devices in Western countries. So please don't forget these points. Okay, in a phase one, what will you do? Emergency OT, we just stop bleeding, we stop contamination, and we put a Bagota bag and vacuum assisted closure device. In phase 2, which usually happens up to 48 hours from trauma. So from the trauma time up to 48 hours, we keep the patient in SICU and manage him for hypothermia, acidosis, coagulopathy will be managed. Hypothermia, acidosis, coagulopathy will be managed in ICU for these patients. Okay, so please don't forget, they will be managed in ICU and they will be treated for this. And elective OT, after 48 hours, shift the patient, if patient is still alive and stable, shift them to OT and do the definitive treatment at that time. For example, if there is a bowel tear, we do anastomosis. If there is a liver laceration, we repair the liver laceration. Or if there is any other injury which can be repaired, now everything will be done in this time. After 48 hours in an elective OT, and we always close the abdomen now. Please remember, close the abdomen. So this is the point you should not forget in damage control surgery in a hemorrhagic shock. So this is what we say as trauma. So trauma in a hemorrhagic shock, how will you manage the patients? So please don't forget what we are discussing so far is, we are discussing types of shock. The important two types of shock are hemorrhagic shock and septic shock. And in hemorrhagic shock, we are discussing the four classes of hemorrhagic shock and the management of hemorrhagic shock according to various protocols. Like the ATLS manual says, we have to do put two green Venflan and infuse 1 liter of 7.5% hypertonic saline. And CRASH 2 trial also advises injection tranexamic acid, and we use O negative blood, and we transfuse blood in the ratio of 1:1:1 protocol, and we maintain permissible hypotension. And please don't forget, damage control surgery made up of three phases. Phase 1 happens immediately in the OT, phase 2 happens at ICU, and phase 3 happens at elective OT. Please don't forget these points in a management of trauma patients. Okay, so next we are going to discuss on the next important shock, septic shock. Septic shock. So one of the challenging shocks by a surgeon is septic shock. Sepsis manifesting along with a patient having a sepsis manifesting along with hypotension, along with low BP, along with decreased perfusion of organs. So septic shock is characterized by sepsis plus decreased BP plus decreased organ perfusion together is known as septic shock. Decreased organ perfusion is known as septic shock. To define septic shock, going for systemic inflammatory response syndrome. Septic shock will gradually lead to systemic inflammatory response syndrome. To define SIRS, the patient should have two or more of the following. The patient should have two or more of the following parameters. Two or more of the following parameters. What are they? SIRS factors to be included are, I used to remember, like orthopedicians love to do total hip replacement. So remember, orthopedicians love total hip replacement is a mnemonic. So L for leukocyte count, WBC count should be monitored. If it is less than 4 also, it is 1 point is given. If it is more than 12,000 also, it is SIRS. So WBC count, temperature can be less than 35 degrees centigrade or more than 38 degrees centigrade. okay, temperature, then comes heart, respiratory rate and heart rate. So this is leukocyte count, temperature, heart rate, respiratory rate are the values we use in septic shock definition. SIRS definition is this. Please don't forget this slide, high yield slide from Bayley's law. So two or more of the following is defined as SIRS. Temperature less than 35 degrees centigrade or more than 38 degrees centigrade. Heart rate more than 90 beats. Respiratory rate is increased more than 20 or otherwise. And the partial pressure of carbon dioxide is less than 32. Or when the leukocyte count is more than 2000, 12,000 or less than 4,000 is known as SIRS. So this question has been asked 3 times in the last 2 years. So SIRS criteria. To say this is SIRS, what are the criteria included? And now very interesting is the new scoring systems for sepsis has modified this SIRS into many new values. They had a SOFA score and now the latest score is QSOFA score, quick sequential organ failure assessment score. Quick sequential organ failure assessment score is the latest score used. So this is again another important topic for your exams, QSOFA score. In a defining of sepsis, you should not forget what is QSOFA. So previously sequential organ failure assessment score was a very big score, multiple values are there. Now the latest score is quick sequential organ failure assessment score. I used to remember as Royal Challengers Bangalore, RCB. RCB will be sitting in the sofa, remember like that. Royal Challengers Bangalore is the score. Respiratory rate more than 22 per minute. C for confused status of the patient, confused status of the patient. B for the BP is less than 100. Okay, this is known as QSOFA score. This is QSOFA score, systolic blood pressure less than 100. Confused status, respiratory rate more than 122. Each one is given 1 point and if the score is more than 2, it carries 10% mortality. If the score is more than 2, it carries 10% mortality in this cases. So please don't forget, when you are managing the sepsis, the points you should not forget are the manage before understanding sepsis, please understand SIRS is orthopedician's love total hip replacement. Leukocyte count, temperature, heart rate, respiratory rate and QSOFA, Royal Challengers Bangalore will be sitting in the sofa. So respiratory rate more than 22, confused state of the patient, BP less than 100, systolic BP less than 100, give 1 point. If the point score is more than 2 or more than or equal to 2, that is 10% mortality in these QSOFA score. It is the latest scoring system used. So now we are management of septic shock patient. How are you going to manage a septic shock patient? All of you know very well, septic shock patient, there is no fluid loss, there is no blood loss. The fluid and blood, everything is pulled into the peripheral vessels. So what you should do is, first of all, the pathology is somewhere there is sepsis. Eradicate the sepsis. Eradicate the septic foci, that is most important point. For example, if a patient is having a perforation peritonitis, do laparotomy, wash and keep the bowel as ileostomy. Eradicate the sepsis and then give antibiotics. Antibiotics should be started immediately to remove the circulating toxins. And very important, we have to do vasopressors. Can you tell me what is the vasopressor of choice for septic shock? Pharmacology question. In a septic shock, the vasopressor of choice is injection, noradrenaline. Noradrenaline is the vasopressor of choice, not dopamine. Please remember, in a septic shock, the fluid of choice for, sorry, the drug of choice for increasing BP is noradrenaline. So septic shock is managed in this way. So we have discussed shock, hypovolemic shock and septic shock. When we discuss about these shocks, we always should know a few points about the blood bank. Let me discuss the points given in Bayley and Love about blood bank and blood products. So this is a high yield topic for your exams. I am taking points purely from Bailey and Lowe, not from any other book. And this is taken from Bailey and Lowe based on UK statistics. So now, one person is going to donate his blood. Let us assume this is a person who is going to donate his blood. He is a donor coming to the blood bank. And he is going to donate the blood. He is donating his blood. How many times per year can he donate blood? One person can donate blood maximum 3 times per year. 3 times per year is a point advised in Bailey and Lowe. And each time he donates how much ml blood? In India we take less amount, but UK statistics they take 450 ml per time when they take the blood. And when they take the blood is taken in a bag which will contain what component? What component is there in this blood bag to store the blood? Old component is citrate, phosphate, dextrose. It's an old component. In those days we were using citrate, phosphate, dextrose. Now we have the latest component. What is it? Which to store the blood is saline, adenine, glucose, mannitol. So the blood taken from the donor is stored in a citrate, phosphate, dextrose content in those days, and it will have an half-life of only 3 weeks. We can store the blood only for 3 weeks using this CPD. Now saline, adenine, glucose, mannitol, we can store the blood for 45 days. The recent blood bags are stored at 45 days because of saline, adenine, glucose, mannitol, and they are stored at a temperature of 2 to 6 degrees centigrade. And in the donor blood, what are the infections you will rule out? We will rule out HIV 1 and 2, hepatitis B virus, hepatitis C virus, and syphilis in India. In Western countries, they also sometimes rule out Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. And to prevent Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease transmission, they do leukocyte depletion. To prevent transfer of this organism, they do leukocyte depletion. So the organisms usually tested in the donor blood are HIV 1-2, HBV, HCV, syphilis, and Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. So these are the organisms that will be ruled out from the patient's blood, from the donor's blood. Now this one unit of blood which is taken out will be made into multiple components. This 450 ml blood which is taken out can be made into packed red blood cell, which will be 330 ml. The problem with the packed red blood cell is they will have no coagulation factors. There will be depleted of coagulation factors. What else will be less in this blood? Coagulation factors will be less and platelets will be less. Okay, platelets and become inactive and coagulation factors are less than packed red blood cell. Therefore, we form new components like fresh frozen plasma, which will be around yellow in color, FFP, which is rich in coagulation factors, especially 2, 7, 9, 10 is rich in this, and it is cryo, it is kept in freezer compartment at minus 40, it is stored at minus 40 degree centigrade for 2 years, fresh frozen plasma is stored at minus 40 degree centigrade for 2 years, and it is deficient in factor 8, so we have a separate component known as factor 8 containing component cryoprecipitate rich in factor 8, which is also stored at minus 40 degrees centigrade for 2 years. And the last component which is separated from the blood bag is platelets. Very important topic for your exams is platelets. So all of you would have seen platelet transfusions being done for which fever? Would have seen for many cases of dengue fever. When the patient goes for platelet deficiency or platelet count going very low, we will transfuse platelets in dengue fever. So platelet is used only for 5 days after separation. After taking the platelets, it can be kept on an agitator. It will be kept on an agitator. It will be continuously shaking like this. If you keep a platelet on this. Otherwise, what will happen? The platelets will get conglomerated. So we will keep it on an agitator so that the platelets will not get attached with each other. So that is stored at a temperature of 24 degree centigrade at a room temperature. 20 to 24 degree centigrade in room temperature we will store the platelets, and we have to use the platelet after forming in 5 days. Take fresh blood and form, take platelets in and use it in 5 days. So platelets can be prepared only from fresh blood. Today if I go and donate blood, today you take my blood and take platelets, and that platelet should be used in 5 days. My packed red blood cell can be used in maximum 45 days, and if the FOB separated from my body will be used maximum in a 2 year period, or cryoprecipitate in a 2 year period. These are the components which are separated from the blood bag. From a blood bag of 450 ml whole blood, these are the components we make. And can you tell me how long will you take it to do cross matching? Will it take to do cross matching? For example, you are an house surgeon. You are going to the blood bank with your sample of blood to get one unit of blood. So cross matching will be done by the blood bank medical officer, and they will give the cross matched blood in how many hours? In 45 minutes they will give. It will take 45 minutes minimum to do cross matching and hand over you the blood bag. So you carry the blood bag now, and you should transfuse this in how many hours? Maximum 1 to 4 hours we should transfuse the blood. So within 4 hours we have to transfuse the blood taken out of the fridge in, and to be completed in 1 to 4 hours. Please don't forget this point. 1 to 4 hours we have to complete the blood transfusion. And if you want to do uncross matched things, uncross matched in an emergency, I want to do blood transfusion. I told you we use O negative in females, O positive for males and post reproductive females. And if you want a plasma, if you want a plasma, what uncross matched plasma will you use? This question came last year. Many of them wrote as O negative. The answer is AB plasma is used for uncross matched cases. So when you are transfusing blood along with the plasma we use AB, and uncross matched O negative blood is used. Okay, and what do you mean by massive blood transfusion protocol? Massive blood transfusion protocol in which we transfuse 10 units of packed red blood cell is to plasma is to platelets in the ratio of 1:1:1. 10 units packed red blood cell, 10 units plasma, 10 units platelets are transfused, is known as massive blood transfusion. When you do a massive blood transfusion, the major problem happening is because of the citrate phosphate dextrose component inside, the citrate gets converted to, please understand this point, the citrate storage components gets converted to bicarbonate and results in a formation of so much of bicarbonate in the body of the patient, so they get metabolic alkalosis. This is a question asked recent AIIMS. So metabolic alkalosis happens, hyperkalemia happens. So the important metabolic disturbance happening in a massive blood transfusion is hyperkalemia, metabolic alkalosis, and there will be hypothermia, hypocalcemia, hypomagnesemia, and there will be decreased oxygen carrying capacity, and there will be iron overload, increased iron in the body of the patient. So what are the things increased? Bicarbonate increases metabolic alkalosis, potassium increases hyperkalemia, and iron increases. Everything else decreases. Temperature decreases, calcium decreases, magnesium decreases, oxygen carrying capacity decreases due to decrease in 2,3-diphosphoglycerate. Oxygen carrying capacity decreases. These are the complications of massive blood transfusion from Bayley's law. These are the points from Bayley's law. Okay, when you are doing a blood transfusion, what is the most common complication of blood transfusion? Most common complication of doing a blood transfusion is non-hemolytic febrile reaction. Most of you would have seen as an house surgeon this reaction. Patient having fever with chills and rigors, immediately you will put Avil Decadron. What is the reason for this? It is due to the WBC present in the donor's blood. The WBC present in the donor's blood causes non-hemolytic febrile reaction. Please don't forget. So this can be prevented by special filters now available known as leukocyte depletion filter. Asked in AIIMS as an image based question. I will show you that image. So non-hemolytic febrile reaction, we use leukocyte depletion filter, which will remove the WBC before transfusion. And TALI, transfusion associated lung injury, is another complication in transfusion, especially with what? Especially seen with fresh frozen plasma. So TALI, transfusion associated, transfusion related acute lung injury, is more common with FFP. And you all would have seen patients on anesthesia, when a patient is on anesthesia and blood is getting transfused, what is the first sign? Patient on anesthesia, blood is being transfused, what is the first sign in anesthetized patient? I hope you all know what will be the first sign in unanesthetized awake patient. If I transfuse an wrong cross match blood for you, the first symptom you will develop is itching. The first symptom immediately, the moment I transfuse blood, you will start developing itching. Sir, I am the moment 1 ml, 2 ml go inside, also you will start itching. Sir, I am having severe itching. Stop the blood. So itching will be the first sign. In an anesthetized patient, surgery is going on. What will be the first sign, and who will tell the sign? The surgeon will tell, sir, there is an unusual bleeding going on. I am operating, already stopped blood vessels. Now unusual bleeding seen. Unusual bleeding from operative site. Like skin bleed will happen now. Skin bleed has stopped half an hour back. Now there is suddenly a skin bleeding, unusual bleeding, followed by sudden fall in BP, followed by hematuria happens in anesthetized patient. So in anesthetized patient, you should be very careful to look for unusual bleeding at the operative site, fallen BP and hematuria are the various features of anesthetized patients. In unanesthetized patients, you can easily catch them by seeing the itching. They will be having itching. Okay, so these are the points you should not forget in blood transfusion. And whatever may be the blood, we do cross-matching, etc., etc., and we also screen for all infections, still there is risk of transmission of what? Risk of transmission of HIV and hepatitis B virus is still seen in these patients, because the patients may be in a window period while doing the testing. So the risk of transmission of infections is still present in blood transfusion. This completes the blood transfusion chapter. Let us see the PowerPoint of this chapter now. So shock is a very important chapter. I hope you all should understand shock first of all. So shock is so simple chapter. So please don't forget these points in shock. The types of shocks I am going to discuss are only hypovolemic and septic shock. So this is a picture I showed you. In which shock mixed venous oxygen saturation is less than 50%? Can you tell me? In which shock it is less than 50%? It is hemorrhagic shock. In which shock it is more than 70%? It is in septic shock. So please don't forget mixed venous oxygen saturation, high yield question. Less than 50% in hypovolemic shock, more than 70% in septic shock. Please don't forget this point. So normal mixed venous oxygen saturation is 50 to 70%. And when you see the values, cardiac output is low in hypovolemic shock, vascular resistance is increased, venous pressure is low, mixed venous oxygen saturation is low. Similarly, distributive shock, when you go, cardiac output is high, vascular resistance is low, venous pressure is low, MVOS is high. Okay. So all these points you should not forget in shock. And in Bailey and Lau, there is an interesting table. I want you to put that table because this may be asked in your exam. See this table. Systemic perfusion, base deficit, lactate level and MVOS are tested. For measuring the systemic perfusion, we do base deficit, lactate and mixed venous saturation. And for GIT perfusion and muscle perfusion, they are now using infrared spectroscopy and tissue oxygen electrode are used. And you can see for gut, they are using gut mucosal pH, laser flow Doppler flowmetry, sublingual capnometry are all used for gut. And for kidney, we are using urine output. And for brain, we are using conscious level as well as tissue oxygen electrode and near infrared spectroscopy. So So though this question is not asked in exam, so since this table looks attractive, the future examiners may ask question from this to measure the systemic perfusion. What is the investigations used? Base deficit, lactate level, and MVOS. And for brain perfusion, we use tissue oxygen electrode and near infrared spectroscopy. And the question which can be asked is for gut. For gut, we use sublingual capnometry, gut mucosal pH, and laser flow dopplometry. Laser Doppler flowmetry is used. Just have an idea. If by chance it comes in exam, we can answer this. So, what are the final monitoring values? Please don't forget, urine output is the best clinical parameter for all kinds of shocks. Adequacy of resuscitation and response is best monitored again by urine output. Accurate method to monitor IV fluids, inotropic agents, and vasodilators is CVP. No confusion in this. Okay, please don't get confused in this. This is a author's verdict on the controversy topic. I have already told you the values between each, in which shock pulse rate increases. In pulse rate increases in class 2 shock, BP falls in class 3 shock. Please don't forget these two questions. These two questions are very important. Okay. So septic shock, we have discussed about SIRS and SOFA, quick SOFA score. So please don't forget damage control surgery, and about the cannulas we have discussed. And if you see the blood transfusion, we have discussed about the blood transfusion. Blood is stored at 2 to 6 degrees centigrade. FFB is stored at minus 40 degree. Cryoprecipitate stored at minus 40 degree. Platelets is stored at room temperature. Okay, all these points we have discussed. So you can see the fresh frozen plasma and platelet, the packets. And this is a prothrombin complex concentrate which is having rich factors of 2, 7, 9, 10 is there in this. Prothrombin complex concentrate, 2, 7, 9, 10 is rich in this concentrate. So what do you mean by autologous blood transfusion? So if you are very much worried about the cross-matching issues, infection issues, etc., you can donate your own blood and store in the blood bank for 3 weeks. And while you are operating knee replacement or hip replacement, your own blood can be used for you. That is known as autologous blood transfusion. Okay, your own blood used up to 3 weeks. So what happens in a storage of blood? I already told you, there is a rise in potassium concentration, and if there is in the blood, there is reduction of pH. But once you transfuse to the patient, patients will develop metabolic alkalosis. The transfusion, the patients have metabolic alkalosis. So what are the reactions seen in an acute hemolytic reaction, febrile non-hemolytic reaction, anaphylaxis, urticaria, or acute immune-mediated reaction? And delayed reactions are hemolytic reactions, post-transfusion purpura, graft versus host disease, are the immune-mediated problems. Non-immune-mediated are septic complications, circulatory overload, hyperkalemia, hypocalcemia, metabolic alkalosis, infection, and iron load are the various delayed complications you get in blood transfusion. And this is a typical image-based question asked last year. What is this? In a blood bank only we use this. Blood transfusion, this is known as leukocyte depletion filter. Leukocyte filter. Okay, this is your conventional blood. The clots will be filtered by this small filter inside, but this will filter the WBCs also. WBC removing leukocyte filter during blood transfusion. This helps to prevent acute non-hemolytic febrile reaction is prevented when you use this. So these are the various complications I explained you. Please don't forget the complications of massive transfusion. Especially, please don't forget hyperkalemia and metabolic alkalosis. So metabolic alkalosis is due to sodium citrate is metabolized in liver to sodium bicarbonate is the reason for getting a metabolic alkalosis. And this is again a new point from Bailey and Lowe latest edition. At what hemoglobin level intraoperatively you will give blood for the patient? Less than 6 gram patient will benefit from blood. Please remember, will benefit from blood. 6 to 8 gram unlikely to be beneficial in the absence of bleeding. More than 8 gram no indication of transfusion in the absence of other risk factors. So preoperative and perioperative blood transfusion is indicated only when the hemoglobin is less than 6 grams. This is an interesting point because practically we don't follow this. Anesthetist will ask for 10 grams in our hospitals, but what Bailey says is this question can be asked in exam. So probably will benefit from blood transfusion is when the hemoglobin value is less than 6 grams per deciliter. When it is more than 8 grams per deciliter, no indication of transfusion in the absence of any other risk factors. This point is interesting point, and actually the anesthetist should make a cutoff of 8 grams for an elective case. Okay, 8 grams should be made as a cutoff according to this Bailey and Love point. Okay, and this is the right tube we have discussed already. So now we are going to see certain pictures from Ryle's tube. As I already told you, Ryle's tube, it is around 110 to 130 centimeter length. How to insert a Ryle's tube? It should be inserted in a sitting position or in a semi-fowler or fowler position. Sitting with neck flexed is ideal position to insert a Ryle's tube. And how to calculate the ideal length of Ryle's tube is by using the rules known as neck's rule: nose, ear to the xiphoid for adult, and between the midpoint between xiphoid and umbilicus for pediatric age, known as NEMU rule, are the rules used in pediatric age. So how to identify the tip is in the stomach. You can see the typical litmus paper. Once you take the aspirate and put it in the aspirate, the color will change into acidic medium, will change into red color, and if it is an alkaline medium, it will be green color. So there are many types of litmus papers. This is an yellow litmus paper to identify whether the fluid is acidic or alkaline. So next we are going to similarly discuss certain important instruments. I want to discuss here one of the other thing which is used in this emergency cases is Foley's catheter. So Foley's catheter we are going to discuss in detail, one of the favorite topics for AIIMS Institute exams. So we are going to discuss about Foley's catheter now. Foley's catheter is made up of two materials. What are they? It is made up of latex rubber and silicon. So the two materials used for Foley's are latex and silicon. So latex is your common material available in your government hospitals. You will be seeing many latex materials. Latex is rubber material. It has to be replaced maximum 1 month once. We can retain latex Foley's catheter maximum for 1 month, and silicon catheter we can maximum retain for only 3 months. So the silicon advantages, it can be used up to 3 months. You may not be changing the catheter, but latex is monthly once we have to change. And major disadvantage of latex is we have latex allergy is there. Very common. Latex causing allergy is very common in latex catheters. In silicon catheters, the allergy is very less, and it is mostly inert in the bladder. And the catheters can be many types, like a single lumen catheter, to just put a catheter and drain, or a tube lumen, in which the second lumen is to inflate the balloon for self-retaining purpose, or it is three lumens. So one lumen to inflate the balloon and other lumen to irrigate the bladder, irrigation purpose. We use 3 lumen catheter. So 2 lumen is having Foley's balloon to retain purpose. Single lumen is only to drain the urine. So these are the 3 types of Foley's catheter: single lumen, 2 lumen and 3 lumen catheters. And each catheter has a code mark here. Code mark is there inside. There's a code cuff is there. That cuff will have various color codes, like red, orange and green. So please don't forget, red, orange, green are the 3 commonly available Foley's catheters. Red is 18 French catheter, orange is 16 French catheter, green is 14 French catheter. I'll show you all these catheters, don't worry. So red is 18 French, orange is 16 French, green is 14 French catheter. So these catheters, 16 is usually used in males, 14 is usually used in females. There are many more colors and codes. still smaller size catheters are available. I will show you those catheters. So please don't forget. What is this French stands for? French stands for the French unit. So 3 French unit is equal to 3 French unit is equal to 1 millimeter. Or in other words, 1 French is equal to 0.33 millimeters. If it is 16 French, what does it 16 corresponds to? That 16 corresponds to, if this is a cut section of the pollice, if this is a cut section of pollice, this is a midpoint, this is inner diameter of the pollice, this is outer diameter of the pollice, this is circumference of the pollice, which is 16 French means. 16 French corresponds to the outer diameter of pollice. So no confusion in this, no controversy in this. This question has been confused and more confused by many books and faculties. So outer diameter is this. Between the outer, if this is a pollice catheter, from this side to this side, this outer diameter is known as 16 French. The 16 French corresponds to outer diameter. Okay, outer diameter, and not the circumference, and not the inner diameter, and not the radius. So what is 16 French? The 16 French, that 16 French, that value corresponds to outer diameter. How will you inflate the pollice? How will you inflate the pollice? The pollice is inflated by using distilled water. Please don't forget, it is inflated by using distilled water. We should not use normal saline because it can get crystallized and it can block the pollice. So distilled water is used. Normal saline should not be used, and you should also not use air. If you use air, the balloon will float and the urine will not be drained. There will be residual urine inside. So air and normal saline are not used. Only distilled water is used. Retained pollice, how will you remove? You have put a pollice catheter inside and it is retained inside. Retained inside the pollice catheter, how will you remove? So many books say many methods. The ideal method is ultrasound guided puncturing of the balloon. Please remember, ultrasound guided puncture is the ideal method. Other methods are, we can over inflate the balloon and rupture the balloon. That is not the ideal method, because pieces of the balloon will be falling into the bladder and it can form an nidus for foreign body. So ultrasound guided puncture of balloon is the ideal method to remove a retained pollice catheter. Okay, so please don't forget pollice catheter points. Pollice catheter is made up of latex rubber, which is highly allergic. Maximum we have to use it only for 1 month. Silicone catheter is used for maximum 3 months. Single catheter, single double lumen catheter, 3 lumen catheter are the 3 types of catheter. 3 lumen catheter is used for irrigation, and the French corresponds to outer diameter of the pollice catheter. And inflate the pollice catheter only with the distilled water. Please don't forget, you have to inflate it only with distilled water. So these are the points from pollice catheter I want you to know from pollice catheter. So you can see this is green color. What is the size? Can you tell me? This is green color code, which is 14 French, which is used in females. And you can see the orange color, which is used in males, usually 16 French. And very big size catheter is used for irrigation purposes, red, 18 French. And black is used for pediatric, 8 French. Very small catheter, 8 French, black, grey, white, 8, 10, 12. So not asked in the exams, but they have asked the green, orange and red in exams. So please don't forget these three. Other threes are not so important. Black is 8 French. You can see the smaller lumen. So this is pediatric, 8 French. Similarly, black, grey, white, 8, 10, 12. 8, 10, 12 is black, grey, white. So this is a typical latex rubber pollice catheter. This is silicone catheter used by the hospitals. In foreign countries, silicone catheter. So this is a French. The French catheter scale, you can see very well. The outer diameter is used to measure the French catheter scale. Outer diameter is the size of pollice catheter. So from the topic so far we have discussed, let us discuss the questions now. From shock, that is a repeat old question, modified shock index is a formula which is used for heart rate divided by mean atrial pressure. Heart rate divided by mean atrial pressure is known as modified shock index formula. So mean atrial pressure is systolic pressure plus 2 into diastolic pressure divided by 3. Systolic pressure plus 2 into diastolic pressure divided by 3 is known as mean atrial pressure. Okay. So which of the following is considered balanced resuscitation? Which is considered as balanced resuscitation. So please remember, balanced resuscitation means maintaining permissible hypotension to avoid bleeding is the correct answer here. The BP should not be very high to cause re-bleeding, and it should not be very low to cause decreased perfusion to the brain. So it should be an permissible hypotension to avoid bleeding is known as balanced resuscitation. So what is the fluid we use in a resuscitation? 7.5% hypertonic saline is used for resuscitation purposes. Nasogastric tube length is measured. The question is not mentioning about adult or pediatric. So let us assume it is an adult. So it is from nose to ear, ear to xiphoid process. Nose to ear, ear to xiphoid process is for adults. Nose to ear, midpoint between jibisonum and umbilicus for pediatric age group. So this question is also we have discussed regarding elevation of liver enzymes following TPN, which is false. Regarding elevation of liver enzymes following TPN, which is false. So fat-free TPN is needed, true. Intrahepatic cholestasis is a cause, true. Overfeeding is another cause, true. Stop TPN permanently is wrong. It should be stopped only temporarily. So a patient requiring TPN for more than a month via central venous catheter, all are done except. So for a month the patient is on central venous catheter and nutrition. Change central venous catheter every 2 weeks. No, wrong. It should be changed only when there is catheter related sepsis. LFT and blood urea nitrogen, or RFT and LFT, should be done weekly once. Electrolytes must be done weekly twice. Sudden glucose intolerance is an early sign of sepsis is correct. So answer is A. Answer is A. We don't change the catheter frequently. We should change it only when there is signs of sepsis. So please don't forget this point. So monitor LFT and RFT weekly once, monitor electrolytes weekly twice. Elevation of liver enzymes is associated with steatosis due to overfeeding is true. So grade 3 hemorrhage, amount of blood lost in grade 3 hemorrhage is 1500 ml to 2000 ml. Okay, 1500 ml to 2000 ml, or 30 to 40% is grade 3 hemorrhagic shock. Packed red blood cells must be transfused within how many hours? Within 1 to 4 hours we must transfuse packed red blood cells. We should be transfusing packed red blood cells in 1 to 4 hours. How will you insert this tube, Reich's tube? Sitting with neck flexed position. The Reich's tube is inserted with sitting and neck flexed position. Okay, this is from a paper from article, nasogastric tube insertion, comparison in sitting position and supine position. The best position is sitting with neck flexed. Side effect of massive blood transfusion are all except. I told you hypothermia may happen, hypocalcemia, hypomagnesemia, and what will happen to potassium? There will be hyperkalemia. And also there will be metabolic alkalosis and hyperkalemia is seen in massive blood transfusion protocols. On massive blood transfusion, the following complication occurs. This is a recent November 2019 question. The answer is metabolic alkalosis. Please don't forget, this is a direct question from a journal and articles. So metabolic alkalosis is due to conversion of the citrate in the blood to bicarbonate in the liver. So there will be more of bicarbonate conversion and there will be metabolic alkalosis. A person with massive diarrhea and dehydration presented to emergency room. What is the best size of cannula to infuse maximum fluids? The best size of cannula to infuse maximum fluid is gray. So it is 16 gauge. All of the following are indicated in Q SOFA score. What is the mnemonic I gave for Q SOFA score? It is Royal Challengers Bangalore. Respiratory rate, confused status and low BP. That is answer. Royal Challengers Bangalore, except urine output is not coming under this. French and Foley's catheter refers to, so please don't forget, it is the outer diameter. It is outer diameter which is correct answer. Outer diameter of the catheter. It is not on circumference. It is outer diameter of the Foley's catheter. French and Foley's corresponds to. Okay. So these are the points I want you to remember for your exams.